Hello everyone, in the last session we have discussed about the Java servlet class and how to write this Java servlet class. Right? Now we will discuss the next point, that is a deployment descriptor. Okay, so this is very important as far as execution of servlet is considered. The thing is that we want to discuss about a deployment descriptor. Okay. Now we have identified this particular thing that okay, student passed out with computer engineering degree, but they haven't known about a deployment descriptor. And they feel that this term is very difficult. Now, this term is not at all difficult. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of descriptor? We go one by one. What is the meaning of descriptor? Descriptor means the entity or the thing which can describe. Okay, so which can give some description or information. Okay, describe or give some information. So this is nothing but a descriptor. Okay, and the information about what? Okay, the information about the deployment. Okay, information about the deployment. Okay, the entity or the term which gives the information about the deployment, that is called as a deployment descriptor. Okay, so latter part is very clear to you. Okay. We are giving some description, we are giving some information, okay, and that information is about the deployment process. Deployment is a process, just like a manufacturing, so deployment is also a process. Okay, we are giving information about the deployment process as far as Java application is considered or programming language is considered, that's why it is called as a deployment descriptor. I think the term is now in some sense it is clear to you. Okay, now you can ask me a next question. What do you mean by deployment then? Okay, now what do you mean by deployment? Now consider that, okay, we are discussing about a deployment descriptor. I will abbreviate by using a DD. Now you are writing a Java servlet. Okay, this is our Java servlet. Okay, you are writing a set of steps, okay, or 100 lines of code within this particular Java servlet. Now, your intention is, okay, you want to execute this Java servlet and you want to get the output, right? Okay, when you are getting a client request, okay, you can process that request by using this particular Java servlet and you want to give some output. This is very important. You want to give some output. Output to what? Output to client. You want to give output to your customer. Now, client or customer is interacting with you, client or customer is interacting with the server by using a web application. So it means that client is using some browser. Client is using some browser. So browser can be an Internet Explorer, it can be a Firefox, or it can be a Google Chrome, okay, or any other browser. Okay, there are so many browsers available in today's world. Okay, so client is ready to use any browser, okay, as per his or her own wish. Now the important thing is that, okay, client is giving a request by using a web browser and you want to give a response back to the client by using a web browser itself. That is very important. So it means that your output, your Java servlet class output should be visible on a web browser. Now, JDK does not have any feature. It does not have any feature to show the output on a browser. So browser is not a part of a JDK. Okay, JDK only knows how to show the output by using a console window, that is a black window. Okay. We are using it, okay, when we are doing a core Java programming in semester 4. So servlet or JDK knows about how to show the output by using a console window. Servlet also, or Java also knows about, or JDK also knows about how to show the output by using a GUI. In case of Swing, we are giving output by using a graphical user interface. But Java servlet or JDK environment does not know how to handle the request from the web browser. So Java servlet requires a support. It requires a support of any other entity. Okay, Java servlet or JDK must have a support of any other entity. That entity is Apache Tomcat server. Initially we are using Apache Tomcat server. Okay, there one more server is there, that is Glassfish server. Okay, these are the name of the servers. Okay. So in current world or current reality, okay, there are n number of servers are available. Okay, Okay, but initially there is only one server is available, that is Apache Tomcat server. Now Apache Tomcat server is available, GlassP server is available, so there are number of servers are available. Some IDEs has inbuilt support for the servers. Okay, so our NetBeans IDEs is having a support for GlassP servers as well as Apache Tomcat server. So it is inbuilt support is available in NetBeans 7.1, 7.2 versions. So initial versions of NetBeans, that is a 4.1, 4.2, in those versions, the inbuilt support is not available. So this is just like a case that, okay, initially we are having a desktop machine or computers in which there is a no support for a graphics or LAN gaming, right? Okay, but nowadays we are or NVIDIA. Nowadays we are having a machines, we are having a laptops or a our desktops in which there is an inbuilt graphics card. There is no need to purchase it from outside. Okay, inbuilt it is available. Similarly, you are having now NetBeans versions or NetBeans IDE in which there is an inbuilt support for this server. Similarly, in case of Eclipse also, there is an inbuilt support for this servers. Now, what happens actually? Okay, the thing is that you are writing a Java servlet, okay, and by using these servers, any server out of this list of servers, okay, you can use Apache Tomcat or you can use GlassFish or any other servers. Okay, by using any one server, okay, your output, okay, that is Java servlet output, okay, is given to the, or it is shown on a web browser. So Java servlet output is shown on a web browser, okay, with the help of some server. Okay, you can use any server, Apache Tomcat server, you can use GlassP server or any other server. With the help of these servers, you can show the output on the web browser. Right, so there is a no direct support, okay. JDK cannot directly show the output on a web browser. JDK has to take the help of these servers. Okay, so initially, okay, when we are doing our engineering, okay, it is way back in 2005, 2006. At that time, okay, there is a no inbuilt support for these servers. So what we have to do? Okay, we have to add the binaries of these servers. How to add binaries, we will see it later on, but we have to add the binaries of these servers, that is Apache server or GlassFish servers with our JDK environment, and then we can execute our Java code. Amala tar Java servlet class la execute karaycha asel tar amala kay karava lagat hoto, ya binaries na ghevun yava lagat hoto. Jasa apan aplya machine la suruvatichya kaalamadhye aplya machine madhye jar graphics support nasel tar apan external graphics card add karat hoto. आणि त्यानंतर आपण ग्राफिक्स प्रोग्रामिंग करू शकत होतो. सिमिलरली त्यावेळेला पण हेच करावं लागत होतं की सॉफ्टवेअरमध्ये इनबिल्ट सपोर्ट नसल्यामुळे सर्व्हर किंवा ग्लास कोणत्याही सर्व्हरची बायनरी फाईल आम्हाला ॲड करावी लागत होती. कुठे ॲड करावी लागत होती? JDK एन्व्हायरमेंटमध्ये. आणि त्यानंतर आम्हाला ॲप्लिकेशन रन करता येत होतं. आताच्या काळामध्ये इनबिल्ट सपोर्ट असल्यामुळे IDEमध्ये तुम्हाला ते ॲड करण्याची गरज नाही. डायरेक्टली तुम्ही सिलेक्शन करू शकता. यू कॅन सिलेक्ट युअर required server and then you can execute your application. So it is very easy. The process is very easy. Now the thing is that what we want to understand, okay, we want to understand this particular part. Java servlet is executed by JDK. So for any Java application we require a JDK, we require JVM also, and it is already available. Plus Java servlet, okay, requires support of some server, any server. Okay, it can be a GlassFish, it can be Apache or any other server. Okay, plus it requires a server. Okay, and plus that particular application or that particular output is visible on a web browser. So it requires some browser also. Okay, so this is group, or this is the entire part is a component. This is a one component. Okay, it is a box, and this box is called as a web container. So in case of Core Java, we are having a single application. We are having a single Java classes. Okay, in case of Java servlet, we cannot independently execute or independently compile any Java servlet. We have to take the help of particular server, then we have to take the help of any web browser. And with the help of all these three things, now we can process the request given by the client. And all these three things creates a box, creates a container, and that is called as a web container. Okay. Now we are discussing about the deployment descriptor. You can make a note of this. Okay, if you require that, then you can pause this particular video. Okay, make this diagram in your notebook, and then you can see the next part of this particular video. It is very important. Okay, I am writing something on a board. Okay, it is just like a board. Okay, I am writing something on a whiteboard. You have to note down these things in your notebook. Okay, and you have to maintain the notebook. That is very important. So in offline way, it is very possible that I can write something on a board. Okay, I can give some time for you, and then you can note down it. Okay, that's why in on offline lectures we require a 40 to 50 minutes to deliver a particular point. In online mode, it is not required because you can easily pause your video. Okay, you can note down these things in your notebook and you can go forward. So each and every time I will not tell you, okay, you can note down these things. Okay, you have to note down it. When I am writing on a board, you have to note down it. Okay, or I am showing some PPT, you have to note down important points. That is very important. So you should sit with your pen, pencil, then your notebook and so on. Okay, you should have a study material along with you. Now the next point is that this is a web container and we are discussing about a deployment descriptor. Now what happens? Okay, we have created a Java servlet. You have created a Java servlet. So JDK or JVM knows about this Java servlet. Okay, so it is basically for our Java code only. So it knows about a Java servlet and the methods which are available inside a Java servlet class. But your server, this particular Glassfish server or Apache server, does not know about a Java servlet, as well as web browser. The web browser can be Internet Explorer, it can be Google Chrome, it can be a Firefox. Does not know about the Java servlet code. So what happens? Okay, these things, these entities, these are the external entities. Glassfish server or Apache Tomcat server or web browser, these are the external entities. These external entities should know or should get the information about the Java servlet. Okay, information about the Java servlet should be known to whom? The information about the Java servlet should be known to the server which you are using, as well as browser you are using. Okay, so you have to describe about this Java servlet. Okay, you can describe about this Java servlet, and that is called as a deployment descriptor. Right? That is called as a deployment descriptor. And you can describe about the Java servlet by using a file called as a web.xml file. This is not a HTML file, it is a XML file. So XML is a extended markup language. You have seen it in your previous classes, previous year, in your first and second year of your diploma. You have seen about the HTML part, you have also seen about the XML part. So XML is an extended markup language. Okay, and it is, the file name is a web.xml. Why it is called as a web.xml? As because, okay, it gives the description about a Java servlet which is present inside a web container, right? So it gives the information of web container, hence it is called as a web.xml. Now the important thing is that, okay, you can create a XML file by using any name. Okay, you can create HTML file by using your own name. Similarly, you can create XML file by using any name. But in case of your web container or in case of Java servlet execution is considered, we have to give a same name. The name is web.xml and it is fixed by the architecture developer. It is not fixed by the application programmer. It is given by the architecture developer. You cannot change it. So you have to use web.xml as a name of the file each and every time. So it is mandatory for you, right? Okay. So now we will see the next part. So we have discussed about these things. Okay, we have discussed about that web.xml part. And web.xml is responsible to give a information of a servlet as well as web container. Java servlet as well as web container. So web container is having some other components also. Hence this particular web.xml is also called as a deployment descriptor. Okay, this is nothing but a deployment descriptor. Your XML file, web.xml file, it is also called as a deployment descriptor. And it gives the information about the servlet as well as requirement of a servlet, that is a browser, server, and so on. And the information is given to the Apache Tomcat server or Glassfish server or web browser. Accordingly, according to that information, the output is shown on a client screen or output is given to the client, right? So I will show you, okay, how this particular web.xml file displays. okay, how this particular file you can see. I will just show you the representation. Okay, later on we will create this particular deployment descriptor. Don't worry about it. Okay, I will tell you how to create it. Okay, you can just see this particular deployment descriptor. That is a web.xml file. This is nothing but our web.xml file. This is web.xml file. So how this looks like? This looks like in this manner. It is having some servlet tags. Okay, within that servlet tag, these are the servlet tag. Within that servlet tag, it is having a servlet name and servlet class. I will tell you what is the significance of these tags. So these are the tags. Okay, and inside the tag, you are writing some input value. Then next part is the servlet mapping. Okay, so it starts at this point, end is at this point. Okay, within that servlet mapping, you are having a servlet name and URL pattern. So in the next sessions, we will discuss how to write this web.xml file, what is the significance of various tags, XML tags present in this particular deployment descriptor or web.xml file, and how to finally write our Java servlet application, as well as how to compile and execute it. Okay, thank you for watching this video. Okay, make a note of all required input given to you, as well as I will share the PPT once this particular sessions, Java Solid sessions, will get over. Okay, thank you for watching it.